Good evening. Welcome to the 2018 Community Christmas Celebration in the lovely Frank Heald Auditorium. Winter is here in earnest and the Christmas spirit is alive. My name is Bruce Schmidt and this is my first year as the MC, so be gentle. I know I can't fill George Thompson's shoes, but I think I can keep the tradition of excellent jokes going on. This annual event is now in its ninth year. Tonight we'll be celebrating the Christmas season by showcasing local personalities and talents. And there's no shortage of talents in our community, as we will soon hear. This Christmas celebration has become an annual event sponsored by FOLA, Friends of the Ludlow Auditorium. We're very lucky to have this facility in our town and have members of the Friends of the Ludlow Auditorium to thank for all their hard work and fundraising. Throughout the program, I will be talking a little bit about different things that have happened and how Christmas has come to light through the years. So it goes without saying that you should turn off any electronic devices that you have ringers or turn them to vibrate. And if you do need to leave, I'd ask that you wait to do so until the act is finished so as not to distract the performers. So we have our first act. It's 12 Days of Christmas with the Black River High School Chorus, directed by Catherine Hurley. And we have Sam McMillan and Phoenix Drake.
Kaka! the last song we sing. Bonjour. Paul.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas.
South Pole. Bipolar. Oh, that one wasn't very good. I get better. Did you hear about the broke Santa Claus? He was Saint Nicholas. So we're going to move on to some better better performers. Now we have the Mount Holly and Ludlow Elementary Chorus, and they're going to be singing for us under the direction of Mary Barron.
Ridiculous. Don't believe it. That rumor has been around for years, and it makes me mad, plain mad. Now put your coat on and let's go. Go, go where, Grandma, I asked. I haven't even finished my second world-famous cinnamon bun. Where turned out to be Kirby's General Store, the one store in town that had a little bit of everything. As we walked through the stores, Grandma handed me $10. That was a bundle in those days. Take this money, she said, and buy something for someone who needs it. I'll wait for you in the car. Then she turned and walked out of Kirby's. I was only 8 years old. I'd often gone shopping with my mother, but never had I shopped for anything all by myself. Oh, the store seemed big and crowded, full of people scrambling to finish their Christmas shopping. For a few minutes, I just stood there, confused, clutching that $10 bill, wondering what to buy and who on earth to buy it for. I thought of everyone I knew, my family, my friends, my neighbors, the kids at school, the people who went to my church. I was just about thought out when I suddenly thought of Bobby Decker. He was a kid with bad breath and messy hair, and he sat right behind me in Mrs. Pollock's grade 2 class. Bobby Decker didn't have a coat. I knew that because he never went out to recess during the winter. His mother always wrote a note telling the teacher that he had a cough. But all we kids knew that Bobby Decker didn't have a cough. He just didn't have a good coat. I fingered that $10 bill with growing excitement. I would buy Bobby Decker a coat. I settled on a red corduroy one that had a hood to it. It really looked really warm, and he would like it. Is that a Christmas present for someone? The lady behind the counter asked kindly as I laid my $10 down. Yes, ma'am, I replied shyly. It's for Bobby. The nice lady smiled at me as I told her about Bobby really needing a good winter coat. I didn't get any change, but she put the coat in the bag, smiled again, and wished me a Merry Christmas. That evening, Grandma helped me wrap the coat. A little tag fell out of the coat, and Grandma tucked it in her Bible. The coat was wrapped in Christmas paper and ribbons, and we wrote "To Bobby from Santa Claus" on it. Grandma said that Santa always insisted on secrecy. Then she drove me over to Bobby Decker's house, explaining as we went that I was now and forever officially one of Santa's helpers. Grandma parked down the street from Bobby's house, and she and I crept noiselessly and hid in the bushes by the front lawn. Then Grandma gave me a nudge. All right, Santa, she whispered, get going. I took a deep breath, dashed for the front door, threw the present down on the step, pounded his door, and flew back to the safety of the bushes and Grandma. Together, we waited breathlessly in the darkness for the front door to open. Finally, it did, and there stood Bobby. 50 years have passed, and it hasn't dimmed the thrill of those moments spent shivering beside my Grandma in Bobby Decker's bushes. That night I realized that those awful rumors about Santa Claus were just what Grandma said they were. Ridiculous. Santa was alive and well, and we were on his team. I still have Grandma's Bible, and just now, as I was thumbing through it, I found the little tag that she tucked inside it that night. It reads, Kirby's General Store, $20. I remember I only had $10 to spend. Well, I will always remember my grandma's world-famous cinnamon buns and what she used to say. May you always have love to share, health to spare, and friends that care. And always, always keep the magic of Santa Claus in your heart. Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Christmas and holiday celebrations are celebrated all over the world in about 160 countries. When you look at the ones that are most popular, Hanukkah and Christmas are probably the top, but there's also Kwanzaa, which in the United States is where roughly 5 million people celebrate each year. It actually begins on December 26th and ends on January 1st. On the sixth day of Kwanzaa, there's a celebration, which is a big feast. Gifts are exchanged, and the gifts are very creative. Kwanzaa is also celebrated through the lighting of a canara. It's an African principle with African principles in history. Our next performer is the Black River High School Chorus, directed by Catherine Hurley. According to legend, a candy maker represents the Holy Christ life. Candy has to be hard to represent the church being built on solid rock, because Jesus is known as the shepherd. It was formed in the shape of a shepherd's staff, and turning it upside down, it represents the letter J for Jesus. The three small red stripes represented the Jesus suffering on his way to the cross. The one large red stripe represented the blood Jesus shed as payment for his sins. The white stripes represent the sinless nature of Christ. In thinking about Christmas and all that comes with it, it's a time to reflect but it's also a time to remember those that are in need. Our next act is The Night Before Christmas by the Ludlow Elementary School sixth graders, directed by Heidi Bates.
Snow, give the luster of midday to objects below. From what to my wondering eyes should
Christmas is coming. He looks at his calendar. So our next performer is Andy Olotnicki, who's going to be doing Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
chimney when the fire is on. Chris Kringle. What do you get if you team Santa with a detective? Santa Clues. All right, we're going to go into some real performance. So, we're going to have Mount Holly and Ludlow Elementary Chorus combine to sing us a couple old favorites under the direction of Mary Barron. I think it's a sing-along. So if you ever wondered why are there Christmas trees, Germany is credited with starting the Christmas tree tradition as we know it in the 16th century when devout Christians brought decorated trees into their homes. Some built Christmas pyramids of wood and decorated them with evergreens and candles if wood was scarce. So we are so excited tonight to have four ladies from the Happy Valley Retirement Home here to entertain us. I want to welcome Mary Sue, Sally Mae, Sue Ellen, and Betty Ann. Drummer boy with Dean Alexander.
second time I've sung this song in public. The last time was about 50 years ago. But it's been a favorite of mine ever since, and it's been my pleasure to share it with you.
Long they told me far
Sasha Corden is going to do Winter Wonderland. Snowman put on their icebergs. Chili sauce. Come on, we're almost done. You gotta give me something. I'm sure that, you know, as we go through the Christmas season, you know, and try to understand a little bit of the traditions, a little bit about the 12 days of Christmas. Story goes that from 1558 until 1829, people in England were not allowed to practice their faith openly. During this era, the song, The 12 Days of Christmas, was written as a subtle way of celebrating Christ's birth in public without risk of prosecution. The 12 Days of Christmas begin on Christmas Day and run until January 7th. The period before that is Advent, the time of preparation for Christmas. Our next act is a story about a movie producer and a scriptwriter who developed a story that turned out to be the story of Nativity. With Paul Ferrero and Will Hunter.
No, thank you.
Sorry, folks, I missed that. I thought there was something else before this.
Screenwriter, I have an idea for the greatest movie epic of all time. It's an honor. I'm...
Sit down.
Okay.
Take notes. I'm on no sleep, 10 cups of coffee, 2 cans of Red Bull, and a bag of Twizzlers for lunch. But I've come up with the greatest movie idea of all time. All time!
Okay.
There's a man and a woman and a baby. A special baby.
A special baby? You mean like a seed of the devil baby?
No. The opposite.
Okay.
He's special, but in a good way. No, a great way.
Okay. That could be an interesting twist to work with. A family movie, maybe with a love story between the baby's parents.
Oh, yeah. Baby's parents. Ooh, the baby's parents. They have to travel to the father's hometown, but when they get there, there's some kind of a crisis and all the hotels are closed, so they end up in a warehouse, a shipping container.
Nice, like an art house, bohemian kind of feel, set design, we'll love it.
Then there's a crisis. Let's see.
I know. She goes into labor at the worst possible time.
Yeah, I love it. They can't find a doctor, so they need some kind of makeshift crib, yada, yada, yada. Oh, and then some blue-collar guys in town come by to help.
Blue-collar?
Yeah, working stiffs, you know, welders, dock workers. I got farmers.
Farmers? Coming to a warehouse in the middle of a city?
Yeah.
Why?
Because only the common man knows that this baby is special.
Okay, I think I get where you're going now. Something the regular working person can relate to. And the farmers come to help out, somehow.
Help out, hang out, I don't know, something like that. You're the writer. You figure it out. Oh, I got it. The birth scene ends with a long pull-out camera shot of the father, the mother, the baby, and the visitors in the warehouse for an iconic final shot.
Nice. That could work. So, what does the baby do that's so special?
Nothing? Nothing yet.
Oh, I see a sequel coming.
Can you do it?
Sure. It's sparse, but I can make something of it. It's a great premise, a feel-good story. It sets up a sequel. I can make it into a full-length movie, a book, maybe both.
Actually, let's add a little more to punch it up.
Okay, but I really don't need anything else. I've started with a lot less.
I want the birth itself to be special.
Like an alien fringe thing where the kid comes exploding out of?
No, not the birth. The conception.
Uh-huh. You want the conception to be special? Like Boom Chicka Wow Wow? That's an entirely different movie, sir. That could cause problems with the rating board.
Boom Chicka Wow Wow, what's wrong with you? There are kids here.
Kids? Where? We're in your office.
Oh, there will be children watching this movie. I want this to be PG, PG-13 at the most, so no Boom Chicka Wow Wow. The opposite of that.
What kind of special conception is the opposite of that?
You're the writer, you figure it out. Taxes. I hate taxes. Why aren't you writing this down?
So is it political now?
Animals. I love animals.
Animals? You mean like a dog or a cat? I know, a talking pet who rescues the baby.
A talking animal? Please, be realistic here.
Yeah, right. That would be the crazy part.
No, just, you know, someplace where there'd be livestock around. Oh, I know, we need exotic visitors from another land with fancy gifts.
So it's a huge costume drama now? You know, this budget's gonna go through the roof.
A crazy king, and he does something so evil, people will gasp in horror.
Now it's a horror movie? I don't know, sir.
An escape to a foreign country. Now that's a huge epic, right?
Epic isn't a word I'd use. Well, I'm schizophrenic.
What was that?
Nothing, sir, but you're talking Hunger Games size here. 3 to 4 books and movies. If I can get all of this to make sense in the same story, I don't know.
A star.
Yes, you're making sense. If we could get a big star to sign on, we might be able to get this green-lighted. I'm thinking Russell Crowe, Jennifer Lawrence.
No, not that kind of star. I mean a star in the sky, like a comet.
Hurling towards Earth to destroy it, like a disaster movie?
No, the opposite of that.
Well, what's the opposite of?
Ooh, and angels. Angels coming and going all over the place, and a musical number.
You mean like Broadway?
Bigger.
Maybe I'll just have the angels do a musical number.
That's perfect. Listen to this. Yes, this history in half.
So you want a feel-good family love story, art house, political costume drama, horror escape disaster that's not a disaster, supernatural musical historical epic with animals and angels. Is there anything else?
Peace.
Oh yeah, peace, man.
No. The story. It brings peace to the whole world.
Of course it does.
What would it take to do all that?
You mean aside from like a $1 billion budget?
Yeah, aside from that.
Okay, so this is Lord of the Rings territory now. We're talking 3 to 4 huge books, 5 to 7 movies, maybe a theme park. We're practically creating a new religion here.
Oh no, we're not doing that. The last thing the world needs is a new religion.
Okay, it's nice to know you draw the line somewhere, but I gotta tell you, I don't see how any of it will make sense in the same story.
Well, work on it, and get back to me in a week.
Joseph, son of David, What is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. This story will really work well. I'm going to go home and read some more about this.
Thank you, Will and Paula. Well, we're coming to the end of a great event. We have a special guest tonight. But as we finish this evening with our final act, we want to take the time to thank those who have made this evening one to remember. All of our cast members, because without them it would not have been possible. The Town of Ludlow staff, thanks to the support of the use of the Frank Heald Auditorium. Our director, Sandra Russo. Our sound and lighting guy, Scott Stearns. And of course you, as the audience, thank you so much for attending. And please welcome Sandra Russo, our director.
Anyway, he thanked everyone, but I do want to thank our piano player, Jerry. He came in the last minute, the first piano player, overbooked himself, so Jerry came in. I want to thank Scotty up there. He worked with me through all of this. I must have sent 100 emails to everybody. You won't be getting any more emails from me. Thank you, Scotty. And a special thanks to Bruce. He took this on, and he told me he was going to do all these changes and costumes, and he really brought it, and he thought it was so funny. And a nice round of applause. And thank you all for coming, and the big guy with the red suit and the beard is coming out.
So now we have a sing-along with the Black River High School Chorus. Santa Claus is coming to town. without him?